It is kind of chilly out today.
Yeah. Oh, were you in the bus or something?
Yeah, it's in the bus. Go up top and show the brass, the braces off. We removed our deck up here, our landing. I have to do something permanent in here. I hate expanded metal. Everybody says, put expanded metal there. It's like, because it has so much freaking surface area. You know, I got a piece of it laying over there on the box is our sand hopper, and I got a piece of expanded metal laying there, but it has so much surface area that you have to protect it, you know, from, you got to be able to maintain it. So I'm not sure. Maybe I'm thinking about some of our wood tiles up here. Maybe one that would hinge, because there will be a pin in this that stops this whole gangway from rotating that we have to access. Well, that could just be a little hatch through the top, maybe. I don't know. We got to think about something permanent up here. They do make expanded metal and stainless. Maybe that's the way to go. They actually sell it here. The guy locally does it. Probably a lot of wind. We've been getting some welding done today. Well, not today. This week. I took a couple days off. What was nice. You can see all the braces are back onto the boat since we're putting the bulwark on permanently. And they're all tacked in. And so they all have to be fully welded. A lot of welding to be done. Done most of the welding down the port side here, but not just the starboard on the inside. Haven't gone down the outside of that with the all the way with the welder yet. So that's where we're at, and our 12VS got us a little boost this week. I was contacted by Colin from Radiarc. He's a marketing guy, and they wanted us to do some promo videos for them and their equipment. But yeah, we got to thinking about that. That's really, boy, this would be funny if I fell right here, wouldn't it? There we go. We decided not to do that. We'll talk about that a little bit. I got shade material hanging from the pilot house there. That gives me a nice windbreak under there. It's a little too windy for even that today because it's gusting around the corner of the boat there. But tomorrow, 5 mile an hour winds. We don't even have to put up windbreaks tomorrow. So plan to do what we can today and then weld like fury tomorrow. And David, who was here recently, this past week, did a beautiful job of fixing up. I tell you what, I didn't expect, you know, these are actually a side product. You know, the thing we really wanted was the big heavy bow rollers for the anchor chain and for lifting loads over the front of the boat. That's why they're so big. These are the main ones. There'll be two. That gives the anchor a little bit of a pitch in. We could do it with one, but I decided, hell, if we're going to go to the time of making the mold and casting them, we'll just make two, and that'll make the anchor come over even easier. And these rollers are just lighter weight ones. All they do is just straighten the chain out to make sure the links are in proper order so that they can go through a chain lock. But anyway, so while we were doing that, we did some of these in aluminum, you know, for our tender. That's going to get welded onto the smaller tender. So we just cast some in Nibrol too. They just came out just gorgeous. Now, you know, I gotta say something about assumptions again. This seems to be a recurring theme. Don't always assume that just because you see something and it's called a cleat and it's getting welded onto a boat, that it's going to be the main way we tie the boat up to a pier. Or, you know, making assumptions is a really dangerous thing, especially with the way I do things. Those are not what's going to hold a 30-ton vessel to a pier, you know, that just doesn't do it, or an anchor or anything like that. But they are great for having all places on the boat because you can tie sheets to them. The sail's got to get, tied off every once in a while. Fenders get hung over. Pumps get lowered down and tied off. So, you know, careful with assumptions. They'll get you into trouble more often than not. Oh, I got to show you this stuff out here, too. Are we on all right? Yes, okay. Technician says we are good to go. Look at, we got all kinds of holes filled in around the yard. Everywhere we had a depression is where a pile of sand went back out into the yard. I used to think that the sodium silica in this sand would kill the grass, but apparently not, because I've had so much of it, you know, off in this section of the yard here. Now, it's not great looking grass. Okay, this is not the lawn and garden channel by any stretch of the imagination, but it didn't kill it all. So I was like, I've dumped it out here. So that's an experiment. Places where you do see it dead is from extremely hot, scalding water getting poured on it. But that is our creation last week. I took, like I said, I took a couple days off, and David and Bart and I, and actually had a group that came out from my office that messed around with these. They did the first two of these. And what these are is our anodes. I keep calling them ingots, so I'm going to try and be careful. They're anodes. And they're made out of aluminum scrap that we had laying around, and 5% zinc. And we had zinc dust because I had some paint that I've got a bargain on that's cold galvanizing paint. So it comes with zinc dust, big, well, I think they're like 44 pound tubs of it. I got two of them, so I think I got 88 pounds of the stuff. But anyway, I'll kick it. If this works, and I'm sure it will, we'll just carry around the zinc dust, and when we need to, we'll make a hole in the sand on the beach and pour some aluminum and zinc into it. And there we go. It must be close to the top of the hour. There's our salt water tank getting tested again. I wanted to add some water to it, and I was just patient. It rained. Look at that. So now the water level's way up high. And you know what? I have all those locking plugs, but I still find a cord every once in a while that doesn't have one. So this cord is going to get a locking plug put on it today. Let's see. Oh, it's warmer in here.
On the pretty table.
Oh, yes. The pretty table. Hi, pretty dogs. Good morning. Finally got most of the crap off the table, and it's actually back to a working table. Hey, what? It really pays. Huh?
I think it can stay clean enough until we can cut out the rest of the panels.
Oh, you want to do them in here?
How easy that would be?
Oh, God, that would be nice. Yes, I think we can actually do that. Okay. Betsy's back to thinking about sales. And so what we want to do is buy some sale material, mark them up on the CNC now that we need, and I'll use that new software I showed in the last video, and then cut them out in here. That's a brilliant idea. Here's our tarmac. We're still collecting pieces for it. Haven't done anything with it yet. I'll tell you what, it bothers me a little bit, but then it's like, yeah, you know, I'm a one-man shop, and well, three or four man shop, but I'm the guy that's in charge of the CNC right now, so haven't made much progress. Oh, I did get this done. I like this because my ROV, when we're working on other things in here, two things happen. Everybody comes along and wants to set tools down on top of the ROV table, which drives me nuts because the wiring harness is kind of delicate. But I put this on. It's just I got a piece of 1-inch square aluminum in there. It could have been PVC, it could have been anything. And it rolls up and it's got two little ledges it sits on when it's up, so I can access and work on my ROV. So I like that. I'm going to try, I don't know when, but it'll be nice, you know. I'll be able to get out here and work on it. I just got a duct tape stuck to it. I was kind of surprised that stuck to plastic that well. I thought I was going to have to come along and sew it, but so far, no sewing required. Let's see. One of our donors is going to recognize that PC. It's getting ready to go out to that kid we talked about that's learning Arduino when he comes back by here. And oh, this thing. This is the next gadget. Somebody, remember we had someone kindly donate this to us. And what I've decided is this thing's beautiful because it's 12 volt DC, right? And the main anchor winch, which is that beast sitting over there, is hydraulically powered, and I gotta get a bigger hydraulic motor for it. That one's too tiny. We still got a lot of work to do on hydraulics. If there's a hydraulic engineer out there that wants to donate a lot of time to us, why, I'd love to have you. This gadget has Bart found the PDF on it, and it's well put together. We thought we'd take this off and change it out. What we decided to do even better is what we need. I'll back up a bit. With that winch out there, can't pick up the anchor because we've lost hydraulic power, or its motor or its lines are down for some reason. This is our way of picking up the anchor. Now, it's not going to lift. This thing only has 1,000 pounds pull, so it's not going to drag the boat up to the anchor and lift the anchor out of the mud. It won't do that. But what we can do is we can sail up on or motor up onto the anchor and just have this thing retracting the chain, because it's 5/8 inch chain. I mean, that's like 22,000 pounds, I think, of strength on it, and a lot of strength. And so the idea is, here's your anchor, you come up on it, all you're doing is you're picking up the anchor chain, and at this point we'd be throwing it onto the deck, so we don't care, we just want to get, you know, gone and not with the main anchor winch running. So we want to weld on a, and they're called, I can't remember the other name for them. One name is a chain gypsy, and that's what I've known by, but somebody else knew them by something else, which actually got hits too. You know, often in the internet, it's knowing the proper word to Google. Do not go to eBay and weld to if you're really, I got a lot really distracted. I went to eBay and I Googled chain gypsy. Okay. I didn't see anything that I want that had to do with winches or anything. Well, maybe winches, but beautiful girls wearing really skinny chains around their bellies. But anyway, we want something that you know, it's got little notches in it that are specifically designed for a 5/8 inch chain. Now, 5/8 inch chain is big, okay? We're talking about, it's the size of the wire that they bend the link, you know, from. So you're talking about a link that's about as, you know, 5/8 inch across, like, you know, a fat finger, okay? And then that gets bent into the whole link. So we're talking about a really big chain here. But we're not talking about a lot of torque, you know? Bob found me one out there, but it was, I think it was made in Philippines. It's 14 and something inches in diameter, so it's a big one. But it's really cool. It had these interesting, like, seesaw slots in it. So, you know, what we want is get something like that, but make it really small. So all we do is just pull chain in, and all we're doing is lifting the chain. When we get right up on the anchor, it pulls 1,000 pounds, and if we overrun the anchor a little bit, and yes, it scratches paint on the front of the boat, don't worry about it, it's a work boat. Pull the anchor out of the mud, and then this thing should be able to lift it right on up. We can also have a pennant line. Our anchors, I have a hole drill through them, and I intend to use pennant lines. And a pennant line is a small steel cable that's attached to the back side of the anchor, not the pointy end, you know. It's connected to the back side so it can drag it out backwards, and that steel cable runs up to the surface to a buoy. And it's a nice thing to do because you let the other guys know that that's where my anchor is. It's out there. So if you pass between that buoy and me, you could snag my anchor rode with your keel. And if it's a plastic boat, it's not going to be me that's going to come out of that fight damaged, you know. I'll get paint scratched again.
Are you going to gear the small winch down to increase its lifting power?
No. If we gear it, you know, it's always a trade-off. If you gear something down, besides that, I'm not gonna fuck with it because it's a beautiful machine as it is. It's got a motor mounted this direction. It's got gears on this side. And it's got a jack shaft that comes across and another gear set on this side. So it's already geared down for the motor. But if you gear it down more, all you're going to do is wait on it longer. You know, so yeah, you could increase its pulling power, but how long do you want to wait to come off to have it bring in 300 feet of 5/8 inch chain? You know, it's just, you don't want to be there all day. So especially once your anchor starts breaking free and dragging, you know, you need to get up on it and get out. You know, and actually the size of the diameter of this would depend on that too. But if we make this thing really big, then we have to mount this over on the side of the cabin top and hang it off.
Show them the bottom.
Which might be good too. The bottom just has a piece of, and we looked at it already, Bart did. It's got screws that hold it all together. It's all sealed up. It's got two bolt holes in it and the wire hole. So we're just going to make something on the deck, on the cabin top, that's a plate of steel that's lifted up maybe a couple inches. So we can get underneath it with a bolt and put up in there. I try to avoid any kind of penetrations through the cabin top. I'd rather have something welded on outside so there's no penetrations, no possibility for leaks.
Are you aware that it came with the manual?
I'm sure it did.
Oh, okay.
Is he on?
I don't know, but it did come with the manual.
Oh, you're telling me.
Box labeled hoist winch.
I didn't, that's amazing that we have the manual.
And we also have the one for the...
He even gave us the push button, that we have the on-off control.
And then it's also the one for the elevator is also up there.
Oh, okay, good. That's nice to know. Betsy's acting secretary, so she keeps...
Well, it's over-organized.
Yeah.
You can't find shit.
No, it is nice. Now I'm getting to know where the boxes are.
Okay, where are the...
And I'm getting to move them to where I think they should be, which really messes me up.
Where is...
Day.
my favorite wrench, you know, the girl's favorite wrench.
Right there. We put it into the tool bucket.
I don't see it.
Beautiful plant.
Oh, it's over there on the side.
There.
Where's the other one?
We got this beautiful thing going on. So if you come to me and you say, where is this? The first question I'm going to ask you is, have you looked at the tool bucket? Okay? Because what we have is when we use something, we put it in the tool bucket. All right, so, and if you need two of them, then you're gonna have to go to one of these things up on the shelves and find the other one.
Which I've not found a wrench yet.
Oh, there's two boxes of winches.
Wrenches.
Where? Actually, Bart was giving me shit the other day because he told me I spelled it winch, but I did not. They're down there, over the lathe.
Well, of course they are.
Right next to Allen wrenches. Yeah, so anyway, I love these things. We may get another one of these, one to stay down here and one to stay up on the boat. And it's just outfitted with all the stuff that we normally use. Yeah, it's been working great. So now it's like, you know, where do I find that question that always gets asked? It's like, have you tried the tool bucket? So there you go, tool bucket.
Okay, I have a question.
Okay, what's the question?
How much anchor chain do you think you're going
to
carry?
I don't know. Lots. It depends. We got a place here in town. We'll hit up Tulsa Chain. They may want to help us out on it. And speaking of helping us out on it, like I said. The marketing guy from Ready Art gave me a call this week, and he got me in touch with the vice president of marketing for those guys. But I have decided it's not in our mission statement or anything like that yet. But I think it ought to be that I don't want to
advertise.
I don't mind advertising. You know, like Chris Faith is doing this shoe thing, string thing, and he's one of our crew members, and so I don't mind helping somebody like that out. But I don't want to get into the business of, you know, they wanted me to do, and it was a really nice offer. I mean, I'm very appreciative of them, you know, thinking that, you know, of us to do this. But to borrow machines out of their rental yard, and they have every freaking welding gadget in the world. So if you need to rent something, I like Ready Arc, you know, because I go over there and Dave is one of the guys. He watches our videos and, you know, he greets us, and they're every one of them has been polite and kind and helpful, and they bend over backwards to try and get my machines in and out in the same day, and so. I assume they do that with all their customers because I don't see why they wouldn't, and they're a fucking great shop, you know? So I don't mind saying good things about them, but if, you see, once you start taking somebody's like, okay, well, I'll make these many videos for you and, you know, for support of your equipment and I get the equipment for, you know, reduced price or free, you know, those type things, you have an obligation to say nice things, and it's written or unwritten. But I don't want to do that. I don't want to find myself in that position. If I find something that, you know, like, I'm sorry to DeWalt again, you know, they gave me those beautiful new grinders, but one of them has an e-brake on it. I just thought that was a piece of crap. Sure enough, it burns up in a matter of a couple of weeks. So I want to be able to say that. And if it offends DeWalt, I'm sorry, guys. I still buy your tools. I think they're great, just nothing with an e-brake on it. You know, if they can't take that, and generally that's not the marketing department's, you know, they don't want that. So they're not going to want me, and I want to be me. I don't want to be anybody else. So there it is, you know.
His comments are kind of funny at times.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anyway.
So anyway, thank you for getting me back on track. I have to put my glasses on. Oh, it's even the right pair. Ready Art, and Tyler Lay, one of our guys, he just lives up north of us here. He builds custom truck beds. Yeah, they're really cool. If you're a welder and you want a big old Lincoln with a customized truck bed to do with it, Tyler is your guy. I guess I'm advertising it. He's also one of our crew members. But, you know, I say what I think. Tyler didn't pay me anything for it. He got me onto, and this is Ready Arc's site, and that's one of their machines. That's a gorgeous machine. This is, oh, I closed down a web page. The other one is called a Lincoln Vantage 400. There it is. Thank God for autosave. Let's get images here of this thing. These machines are of interest to us because it's a welder, yeah, but I wouldn't take it on the boat. Because it has, this one has an Isuzu engine in it. No, not Isuzu. I can't remember the name of it.
It looks like it's bigger than a bread box.
It's the same diesel engine that goes in all those reefers going down the highways on trucks. And it is big. Yeah, the guy's out front, the machine's...
He's not a dwarf?
He's not a dwarf. That's a big machine. It's like 4+ feet long and 3+ feet tall. But it has a nice big diesel, well, not a big diesel, it has a very economic diesel engine in it. It puts out 20 kV of juice in 110, 220, and three phase. So it's great for our plasma cutter, right? The only thing it doesn't do is it doesn't do air, right? But the guys at Radiarc said, oh, you want air? Well, they got this one called a, and look at that, there's a person standing behind it. This one's even bigger. That box right there, that's my welder. That's a 12VS. That's a newer model of it, but I'm happy with the old model. That is a big ass welder, okay? And that thing puts out a bunch of electricity, also 110, 220, three phase, but it has an air compressor built in on it too. And it's enough air to drive a plasma torch.
But so, it has to, wherever it goes, it's pretty much going to live there, huh?
Oh, yeah, yeah. I guess we dedicate the starboard side of the engine room to that and the Tormach mill over there. And, yeah. So, anyway, what I'm looking for is I don't know anything about these welders. Now, Tyler does. But your opinions account to me, too. So, let me know what you think about those type welders. If you want to donate us one, hell, I'll come up and get it. But that one has a Dutz engine on it.
Is there anybody in France with one?
I don't know how you say that.
I'll go get it.
Yeah, yeah, you're not going to go to... Yeah, I bet you would.
I'll bet you there's one down in Key West with my name on it.
Yeah, I'll go to Key West with you to get one. That'd be fine. Anyway, we're looking for a welder. Recommendations. Because the guys at Radiarc, they make me good deals on this stuff, and they said, okay, you check around through our used inventory, and we'll make you a deal on it. But it's not just, I'm not going to limit myself down to just that option. You know, we don't make our final decision until we have to make our final decision. So we're looking for a welder, and your ideas and input on it is fine. The air is really nice. You know, we could run, maybe it could weld, maybe it could put the 220 out for the plasma cutter, and also drive the air compressor at the same time. I'm pretty sure it could, because I think the wattage requirements are fine for that.
Okay, but isn't this kind of like the first version of printers that could fax and copy?
No.
And whatever, and when one thing broke, you were totally screwed?
I do not like that part of it. Yeah, you're right. I do not like that part of it. You know, like, it's like, okay, well, the air compressor is down on this, then you have to fix the air compressor on this. Whereas when you have separate devices, I like that approach much better, because if the air compressor goes out, fine, we can get anybody's air compressor and put back in to replace that air compressor. Whereas if we're off of the Marianas Trench and this thing loses its air, then it's like we gotta get back in to shore, and we gotta find the part to fix this. So that's my commenting.
Kyle is just tearing me up today.
Is he?
His mom has a crush on you.
Does she?
How much are you willing to give me for him?
I'm up for sale in the white slave market now. All right, so that's all I got. Oh, I see Chris is
going. I have got more.
Oh,
I
you
have
do?
Questions.
All right, let's do some questions.
Okay, I got to back up.
Hi, Tinka. You doing? You want to be on camera?
You going
to
tell them about their party?
What party? Oh, yeah. The dogs had a party last night. We went to see a movie. We went to see...
Lost?
No, it wasn't Lost. Lost City of Z. It was good. It was a little... You know, you can tell where Hollywood took over, because this is British guy in the
1920s. Early
1900s, that has this idea that, you know, the Indians in Central America, Brazil, South America, have built these civilizations. That really wasn't a big thought. I don't think he had that. I'd like to see.
He did.
He did, but he was, he put himself up there as kind of like a, you know, it struck me a bit like that stupid movie Avatar.
Wouldn't even go see it.
We're taking this and we're putting them up on a pedestal, and it's just not the British way of doing things. They look down on everybody.
Yes, but he was trying to get the family name back.
Yeah, it was that. Yeah, so yeah.
I mean, if you wanted to get the Jackson name back, I mean, what would you have to do? Build a boat?
No, I'd have to. I can't say what I'd have to. Yeah, that would. Yeah, my dad would love this.
See, there you go. Okay.
Yeah, my dad would love this.
There's a lot of talk about how much chains and anchors weigh, and yeah, I don't want to talk about that. That's boring.
Anchors are 220 pounds. Chain is, oh my God, 5/8 inch chain. It's a lot. And we're going to have a 100 pound sentinel on the chain as well. I've never seen a sentinel done on a chain, but I don't see any problem with doing it. So that'll hang up there too. A sentinel is a, it's between the bow of the boat and the anchor. You know, that you've got this chain that generally goes down and lays along the bottom. And the chain's, a lot of heavy chain is great. That'll be Chris. So when the boat comes up,
could be Jack.
It takes the shock load off, you know, because it's lifting all this weight slowly. The Sentinel is just a lead weight that hangs partway down before it touches the bottom. And so it, you know, it causes the chain to go down to the Sentinel and then over to the anchor. And so it has to, it's, you know, like anything, you can't, if you have a line with a weight in the middle, try pulling that line straight. It's not possible. So you remove all the shock load from it. So.
Okay, so now the big question
that's
is...
That's about anchor. Yeah.
What's next?
Yeah. I don't know. It's
well,
kinda...
okay, there was one specific question of when are you going to build the tender, but you can't build the tender because the sail loft is currently the tender.
Yeah, the tender is the sail loft right now.
So until we
gotta finish
get to
sails.
The point where we don't have enough tender to build sails, we can't have a tender.
Right, so we're going to do sails first, and then we'll be done with the tables, which are the aluminum sheets that will be the tender. So that's the order.
And so what are you working on this weekend?
Well, it's colder than shit right now.
I know, it's 55 degrees. What was it, 85 a couple days ago?
That's the problem. It's just because it dropped after it was so nice, and I don't know, Bart's over there freezing. So I'm going to probably get up there and weld. And behind the windbreak, if the wind's supposed to drop, tomorrow's supposed to be a beautiful welding day. We got a couple days next week. They're supposed to be just gorgeous. Supposed to get back up to 80. So I'll take some vacation next week and do some welding. And
we have Grant coming from California.
Grant's coming in from California. I don't know if he welds, but we'll get down in the cargo hold next and finish the tiles along the edge. That'll be the next thing to do.
And?
Yes. Oh, yes, 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 yes.
It's kind of dirty because I've been spilling.
Been spitting on it?
Yes.
You have coffee?
Yes. You don't like coffee.
I don't mind coffee. I just don't like coffee. There's a difference.
There's people I've felt that way about.
Has there? Such a surprise. Okay. There's our Seeker Poseidon logo, and that there'll be more about what we're doing with that later on. And there is our, the other side says, explore, dream, discover. If you don't know that, that's from Mark Twain. 20 years from now, you'll be more disappointed by the things you didn't do than by the things you did do. So cast off the bow lines, sail away from safe harbor, explore, dream, discover. Okay, one I actually had memorized.
Now,
used
available.
To be, I had the first four chapters of Genesis, but now it's this.
It's warm.
Oh, it is.
Anyway, the things about this mug I like.
Yes.
Because we just have like one or two of the old mugs left, and I'm not sure if we'll reorder those or not. This also holds 15 ounces of liquid.
Yes.
Which is perfect not only for coffee, tea for our friends from the...
the UK.
From the small island.
Yes.
The
British.
Oatmeal. Chili.
Yeah.
Soup.
Can you put Fritos in too?
Yeah, it even holds ice cream. Oh, you can't have that anymore.
I can't do ice cream anymore.
Anyway, the outside is a nice matte finish, meaning it's not shiny on the outside. It's it's really a nice pottery feel to it. And then the inside is shiny red, which hides those stains you get from the coffee and tea.
Does it make it easier to clean?
For those of
is
you
it dishwasher that don't like safe? To
clean. You know, it's as dishwasher safe as the last one.
Yeah.
They say it is. We don't have a dishwasher. Well, we do have a dishwater.
I wash the dishes.
Well, so do I.
Yeah,
and
we share.
Anybody else that comes by.
Yep.
But
if you eat, you wash dishes.
It's the last one has held up to our washing really good.
I haven't broken any of them.
I haven't broken any of them.
But we had two handles fall off the other one, so there's no guarantee on this one. It could just be a Chinese piece of crap.
It's also made by China, but we support China.
We do. We support China. We're building a Chinese junk, so we support China.
But I like it. It has a nice feel.
I like the people that say, you should buy American tools. Well, A, I couldn't afford to build a boat in America if I was buying tools in America. So you got to choose right there. Yeah. Oh, I love China.
I have to catch up in a minute. Anyway. These, because also you'll notice there's two color printing.
Oh yeah, more
we're
money.
Like, you know, we're going upscale here.
Yeah.
So this mug.
Upcharge. What are we selling this for? $40?
$18.
$18, what'd you settle on?
Yeah, the last one was $16, but this one is, it feels a lot better. And it's stunning. Absolutely stunning.
All right. If we don't, we love the support. If you want to buy a mug, buy a mug. We don't need you to buy a mug.
And we will tell you what it costs to ship this to Europe, okay?
Oh, my God, yeah.
Okay, the mug weighs about a pound.
Yeah.
When it's all boxed up. And that cost to England, it's about $16 a pound is what I have figured it costs. You get two mugs. You're going to pay $32 shipping or something like that. There is no like discount.
But you get a free sticker with
it. Now, if you buy three mugs at that point, we can ship it priority. And then you're making a good deal. But you got to buy enough of them because it's like $43. Now, Australia, it's like $25 a pound. Yeah. So, but you can usually throw a t-shirt in with it that doesn't affect it too much. But if you get two mugs or three mugs or something, oh my God.
There you go.
You know, so just keep that in mind.
If you want to make buying something that's way overpriced more economical, there's how to do it. So anyway, we are going to get our nonprofit, our 501c3, and we have a meeting scheduled with the lawyers this Thursday. And so we'll be working on doing that. We will be coming back for money from you guys at some point, just not now.
These work good for vodka too, according to Mike Dittman.
Oh yeah?
Yes.
Oh, didn't take the varnish off?
Kyle said he's buying 32, but I think he's lying. Oh, 35 if they're dishwasher safe.
Yeah, we'll have them printed and ship right to you.
Dustin likes your inspirational phrases. Well, thank God. Have you seen our shirt or our poster?
Yeah, I put one on a poster and nobody bought the poster. So it's like, yeah. I like inspirational stuff too. I put it around me all the time. It's just a great way to keep your head in the right game.
Okay, Kyle says, with all that iron.
Arm.
Why can't you make your own pressure tank built into part of the boat, like weld sides of the tank to the side of the interior of the boat? I'm not done. Then you can just buy the pump and the regulators and place it on top of it. Would that give you the air you're looking for?
Yeah, you can't make a tank that's not round or cylinder with, because if you, I did this once on a submarine. I had an aluminum submarine. I welded it. I was going to build the heat exchanger for the oil into the hull. No, not at, God, what was it? It went to like 60, I don't know, about 60 PSI. I thought, I could do that, you know. So I had the flat hull, and I put in some ribbing about an inch and a half apart. And then I welded the, how did I do that? I reached in from the side as I was building and I welded it in. So it was all welded up. Oh, I did keyhole welds, slot welds. So I got this thing all welded in. Fired the engine up. It was about 2 minutes. Boom! And oil just everywhere inside there. So I was like, God, you know, and it was all bulged up. So I thought, okay, I didn't do a good enough job. So I did a better job, right? 3 minutes later, boom! You know, oil all over the place again. So no. Air tanks and anything that takes pressure have to be round for a reason. Because if you do that, you know, even our skeg, if we put more than, we pressure tested it, I think 3.5 PSI or something like that. If we put like just 14 PSI on those plates, that thing will blow apart. I mean, steel wants to go round once you put pressure on it. So, and we got a round tank. So yeah, we'll take a round tank. We're probably not going to put it under the floor though. We'll probably put it up above because it's just air. It didn't weigh anything. So lightweight stuff goes up. So we'll have a tank, but it'll be the one that I got in the shed in the backyard now.
Can you rub your beard on the mug for his mom?
No, I'm not going to do that.
No, but I have got some dirty socks with her name on it. You name the price. Any plans for selling more wooden tiles in the future? You never know.
I don't know. We got to get the ones. We got to finish what we were doing first.
Let's see. Got to go back.
Maybe wallboard. Maybe we'll do some quotes in the wallboard. Well, we got the. We went out and did the sawmill last week, and Paul's going to help us out by loaning us the
boy, did we see a lot of wood. Of course, it's in tree trunks.
Yeah, yeah. So we got tree trunks and so forth. There's Chris. So we got tree trunks and such. So we may do some carving for the side of the hall.
Cabin layouts, pilot house layout, plumbing, hydraulic lines,
hydraulic.
Electric lines.
Not much electric.
Are you on this? We're not there yet.
Yeah.
None of that happens until you're done welding and we get painted, right?
Yeah, welding first, painting is second.
Now we're working on hydraulics, but just
we're
because...
We're working on a plan of hydraulics, yeah.
Plans are one thing.
But I seriously need somebody that is in the industry that knows all the hydraulic stuff to help us draw that plan.
This Paul guy says that your Cummins powered Onan 50K genset is sitting in his backyard. PM him.
Really?
PM him.
Well, I already have a genset. Oh, 50K? No, sorry. That's very nice of you, but we can't use anything that big. Hugh gave us a little genset. We need a little one that's gasoline so we can take it out, put it in the tender, and move around with a little bit of power. But no, 50 kV is just way too big. I appreciate it though.
Kyle Orr's building a refractory furnace and he's looking at your videos.
Oh, good for you.
Okay, okay. So you're still almost so you're welding up all those little braces.
Well, actually I'm going around the outside of the book
and those holes, and then you're going to make a nice new support at the top of the gangway, right?
Yeah, so you can go up there without having to.
Man, that hole.
It scares the shit out of me. Too.
Little dog is not going to make it over.
Get up there at the top of the plank. It's like, oh shit. Yeah, the handrail goes away. It's just open. So it's like, yeah.
And we're going to do lawnmower repair. It's that time of year again.
Oh, yeah.
That's always so much fun.
Yeah. Well, you're good at that.
I know.
Yeah. Little YouTube videos. All right.
So get Chris.
Chris, come here. Come here. Let me show you Chris's thing. Chris did a successful, and I don't know many people have done successful Kickstarters, but Chris did. Yeah, this is Chris Faith.
Hi.
You've seen him before. He does some camera work for us and so forth like that. This is it.
Yep.
That's a sample pack. Fancy thing. Oh snap!
Yep.
Is that the name of the new product?
No.
No. What's the new product here?
Button up laces.
Button up laces. Okay.
Yeah, I had to change the name.
How do I open this? I'm not. Oh, it's a snap.
Yeah.
Oh, it's your thing. See, he gave me a pair of these of his prototypes for the last one. And actually, I still have on those shoes and they still work. Well, is this what you're marketing now? This thing?
Yeah, so it's the same hardware from the first project that you have.
Right.
And we added new lace options and some pull tabs.
What are these?
Pull tabs.
Oh, they're pull tabs optional, for the...
Like kids or...
Oh, for the end of the lace?
Yeah.
To give them something they can grip onto? That wouldn't be because you've been around children lately, has it?
No, I don't have kids.
Well, you've been around
them. Nieces and nephews, so...
Yeah, I know. This is... So you got three sets of shoestrings in here?
Yeah.
Okay.
There's some samples, but there's the...
Show us how it works.
Flat laces and oval laces.
Are they on your shoes?
Yeah.
Oh, they are?
Well,
that's the demonstration what you're looking for. All right. Yeah, he wears his own product. See, these are, who'd you develop these for?
For myself.
You really? That was it?
Yeah.
What happened? Did you get your shoelaces caught on your bicycle chain one day?
No, I don't ride a bike. I just hate tying my shoes.
Wow, you are a lazy person. Lazy people aren't supposed to start businesses. Jezebel, you gotta get your glove and go on. There you
Ironically,
go.
I spent like the last 3 years on what was supposed to just save me time.
You need to pull your pants like
up. But you have a successful Kickstarter. That's awesome.
The dogs All right. They have a problem. If they see you
get out of the way.
Shoes, they think you're getting ready to go somewhere.
Yeah, so you're going to go somewhere. So show us what it is. See, that is the deal. You don't have to tie your shoelaces. All you do is on and off. Yeah. And then... You tighten it up originally to the how much pressure you want on it, and that's there is to it. Oh, so you slide it. Oh, that's easy to do. So you can adjust it that quick.
Yeah, or
you
can
just slide it down. Tink, come on, girl.
Not so lock it.
So are they stretchy? So for people that have had ankle replacement surgery and their ankle swells all the time.
Yeah, can I show them your ankle?
The laces aren't stretchy, but you can use it with that.
That is ankle replacement surgery. I know, that creeps you out. But the really neat thing here is they drilled in through the heel.
Which is still not healed.
So anyway, what? Tell us about this product. You're doing a second Kickstarter.
Yeah. The first one was successful, but it could have been a lot better. So I didn't do the best job.
Can I open this?
Yeah.
Oh, it sounds like a dog treat.
Well, that sounds like anything we build, you know. So those are the parts to it.
Yeah.
It's like a rivet system.
Yeah, basically there's a balls.
I just spent $100 buying rivets.
So
the little pin goes through where the last eye.
Yeah.
You have various, are these spacers or locks?
They're both. You put the ball stud.
There, yeah. You can show them. Well, we got a treat for both cameras here.
And through the
Through the eyelet. Yeah, there it is, sticking up. Okay.
And then
you get the retainer ring on that. And that's all there is to it?
Yep. And you can use another one on the back side.
Okay.
If you need a spacer.
Right.
So cool.
Is there any shoe that this won't fit on?
It has given me a little bit of trouble with some shoes that have like the metal grommets.
Oh yeah, because they're really thick.
It works with a lot of them, but some of them it doesn't. They're a little too small.
But the majority of running shoes and all that, metal grommets, you're talking about hiking boots, that kind of thing.
Yeah, so it's not the best for a lot of boots, but that's pretty much it. As long as it's got eyelets,
Well, it is a cool deal, and I just love that guys
hold
like...
hold on while you run?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, I've run, that's what I put mine on, I used to run. until I decided that that's just way too painful. But yeah, I've used his stuff on my shoes running, and never had a problem with them. Not once did they come off. And I don't even have your good stuff. I had, you 3D printed mine.
Oh, is that the one you tried?
Yeah, I gave it one of the first ones off the lines. I don't think they were injection molded or anything.
Yeah, these are...
Yeah.
So you've got it, are you...
I've had the crappy ones for years now.
Yeah, these are nylon impact modified. So they're like, they add like fiber to it. I don't know if it's glass fiber or cool. What, but it's
fancy 3D printing stuff. Is that the name of your deal?
Yeah, that's
the
new logo.
This is the new logo. Button up. All right. Well,
what do you think these will sell for eventually?
Actually, I dropped the price on them too. They were like 13 last time.
You're not following our mug marketing approach. Then.
Are you raising prices?
I'll raise prices all the time. Yeah. Yeah.
I've been brainwashed by Walmart, so rolling them back.
So what's the price now? And I'm going to be...
It'll be $10 on the project if you just want one set, or for multiples, then it's even cheaper.
Okay.
If you get like three or crazy people.
Buy for your whole family.
Closet. Yeah.
So are we going to be able to link to that on this?
Yeah. Well,
you have got it. Okay.
Yeah, I'll figure. Well, you're not live yet on this thing yet, are you?
Tuesday.
Tuesday. Oh, I won't put this up till Tuesday, so I'll put a link on the end of this.
Okay.
No, it's live. It is live. It is live. So that camera's live, and this one goes to YouTube.
Oh, I didn't even notice you had two cameras on.
Well, the phone is the camera for the live. We do have the live on Facebook. So if you're watching this on YouTube, we do the live stuff on Facebook, okay? And if you hate Facebook, good for you, all right? There's nothing wrong with hating Facebook. So don't go to it. Just wait for it to come out on YouTube.
Gosh, can't we do a giveaway?
Oh, yeah, I was actually...
Should we? These are mine.
Now I'm a little on the spot. I don't know if I'm talking to live or...
No, well, you're both.
Actually, I did have a thought.
We'll work on that.
Yeah, we'll get back to you.
Okay. You want to give... I don't want to give away mine.
No, we'll work on that.
Yeah, I had something in mind, but I was going to...
Okay. We'll do something behind the scenes for a giveaway.
After all, because what is he working on as your project with the boat? Come on.
Me? Oh... Well, I'm not going to tell what he's working on with the project with the boat.
Oh, they're going to like it, though.
It's top secret. They're going to like it. Well, some of you are going to like it. Some of you are going to hate it. But that's the beautiful thing about this world is we can do what we like, and you don't have to like it. You know, that's just the way it is. You can always choose to be angry and upset about something. But you know what? You're choosing to be angry and upset about it. So, sorry, you know? Try not making that choice, maybe. All right, are we done?
I guess because my comments.
I need a welder.
My comments aren't scrolling anymore, so I don't know what.
Comments are locked up, so we don't have any new questions. So we're gonna sign off here. What I was getting ready to say that I never finished is I just love guys like Chris. Who was that? I went and watched you and two other guys here in Tulsa that had.
There was the bow tie guys.
Yeah, Tim at Two Guys Bow Ties. Yeah. They're here in Tulsa. They make wooden bow ties and wooden rims for fedoras and picket fences for your inside your house now or something.
Drew was
like that.
Telling me something about that. Yeah,
they're doing weird stuff. But anyway, they're making money off of this stuff, you know. So you guys can do this thing. I'm not saying that it's going to be easy. Chris has been he's been doing this for what? How many years
about
on this?
3 years.
3 years, you said on this.
Yeah.
So it doesn't come quick.
And he still has a day job.
Yeah. Do you?
The business.
Yeah. He fixed my window and my. It's which actually still holding up.
Yeah, great. Actually, I wouldn't normally tell normal fans this, but the design for this product was somewhat inspired by my past several years fixing power windows. They've got
rivets falling out of power windows.
Some of the older designs of window regulators for power windows have like ball studs as components in them. They're a lot different, but I've always liked ball stud fasteners because they hold really well and they're pivotal.
Yeah, I don't even know what a ball stud is, except I know what your shoe
just
thing
exactly,
is. I think
exactly
it's that
like
thing.
That. It's pivotal. So like on a window regulator, the old style that is
I've seen that.
Scissors, they ride on these pivoting ball stud type joints. I mean, they're not so easy to, you have to use a C-clamp to actually clamp them in. So.
Force them together.
Yeah, I didn't want that tight of a connection.
We're all inspired by all kinds of things. And that's really what YouTube has been great for me is because, you know, people, I don't watch a lot of YouTube videos by just watching somebody's videos, but I do searches on it a lot, and it's been just fantastic because I find it's like, oh, there's an idea.
Yeah.
And now we've got this audience out there that will post stuff to Facebook, you know. 80% of it, I'm sorry, it's absolute crap, you know, but it's like, well, okay, I can see what he's thinking about. But man, there's 20% of it's like, yeah, I hadn't thought about that. So it wears off. Most people tend to make things way too complicated.
Yeah.
And so it's cool to see a product like yours. It's like, it just simplifies something. It makes it easy, not harder.
Yeah.
So that's beautiful. And I just love that we still have a country and we still have enough ingenuity and creativity that we can go out and do that. So congratulations on your success.
Thank you.
And I hope you guys have success on that too.
Okay, so, your impatient trolls have had enough.
With that, I almost had it line. It was right there on the tip of my tongue.
What did you make today?
What did you make today? Okay. Y'all have a great weekend. Let's go weld some. We can weld. Say good morning, Bart.
Hi, Bart. Oh, I'm sorry. Good morning.